I am not envious of the American anime fans who are waiting for Violet Evergarden to drop on Netflix on April 5th. Not just because they have to wait an obnoxiously long time to actually watch this stunningly beautiful series from KyoAni, but because there aren't enough tissue boxes in the world to sustain an average human through a marathon of it. As one of those sick freaks who really enjoys it when shows make me cry, this winter's anime lineup has been a real blessing. A Place Further Than the Universe and Violet Evergarden have been consistently bringing the feels, as they say, and the last few episodes of Evergarden in particular have been a real emotional roller coaster. It's pretty easy to understand why I'm enjoying Cute Girls Do Antarctica Things so much. The themes of struggling to connect with your peers and of trying your hardest to accomplish something that everyone else thinks is crazy and impossible resonate with my own experience of youth, even if the particulars, like going to Antarctica, don't quite line up with my own experience. It's a very relatable story despite its fantastical elements. But Violet Evergarden isn't so relatable, at least not for me. It speaks to experiences that I've never had, and if I'm lucky, experiences I never will. It's a show about war, and especially about the aftermath of war. And despite ostensibly being about a badass teenage super soldier with steampunk robot arms and a fancy Victorian dress, despite only showing actual fighting in brief flashbacks, it's one of the most grounded, brutal, and emotionally resonant war stories I've ever had the pleasure of watching. Obviously, I don't have a proper frame of reference to say if Violet's experience during and after the war is accurate to real life, although a veteran posting on our anime did say that it felt very accurate to him. But I can say that it feels true to life, which is ultimately what really matters most when it comes to art. Despite Violet's life being so different from mine, I'm able to believe and empathize with her suffering and understand where it comes from. And I think a big part of why that works is the show's structure. Like the excellent Plastic Memories, Violet Evergarden is an episodic series where the protagonist's job, in this case being a ghostwriter who helps people compose important letters, brings her into contact with a vast array of characters and gives her an opportunity to fix their problems. Essentially, it's a series of mostly disconnected, emotionally charged short stories tied together by the hero's personal story arc. It's a formula that allows these shows to deliver small-scale emotional catharsis on a weekly basis, while still building toward the kind of powerful emotional conclusion that can only work if we're given a lot of time to get to know the characters. But its implementation also serves additional purposes in Violet Evergarden. Firstly, witnessing all of these sad stories firsthand is what propels Violet's own character arc forward. As a child soldier, Violet only ever knew the battlefield. She never learned to really understand the feelings of others, or even herself. This is obviously an extreme and exaggerated scenario, but Violet has many of the same fundamental problems as many other soldiers do when they come home from war. Soldiers are trained to follow orders at all costs, to remove empathy for the enemy from the equation, and to be capable of killing. All things which take a toll on the human soul. And to paraphrase that Reddit post, when the war is over, they lose the sense of purpose and direction that those orders gave their lives, and there's nobody to teach them how to be civilians again. The reason that Violet Evergarden becomes an auto memories doll in the first place is to try to understand what her commanding officer meant when he told her he loved her. But pursuing the job highlights her emotional deficiencies in other areas, with her first few letters being formal and factual to the point that they end up saying the opposite of what the clients really want to say. But as she takes on jobs that are increasingly emotionally complex, she starts being able to sympathize and eventually empathize with her clients' feelings. So that by the time episode 10 rolls around, the once emotionally suppressed killing machine has to actively fight back her own tears over the fate of Anne and her mother. And oh man, Violet, I am right here with you on that. I cried so hard after that episode that it gave me a headache. But on top of teaching Violet to better understand others, these stories help us to better understand Violet herself. Because for the most part, these stories are more relatable to us as an audience. Most of us have wanted to help a loved one who's beating themselves up over their mistakes, like Luculia. Or been in love but unsure of how the other person feels, like Princess Charlotte. Or had a loved one pass away, like Oscar Webster. And if we can relate to those experiences while also seeing how Violet relates to them, we can begin to properly understand how she feels by proxy. It's a very smart writing trick for engendering empathy with someone who, at first glance, seems painfully cold, distant, and emotionally stunted. I'm generally not a fan of the so-called three-episode rule, that it takes about three episodes to really get an anime, but Violet Evergarden proves that sometimes it is a necessary policy. A big part of the hype for the series came from the lucky few who got to watch the first three episodes at Anime Expo. Their glowing reviews made it one of the top-rated series on my anime list months before its release. When the first episode finally hit Netflix this winter, though, there was a lot of blowback. Cries of overrated and boring flying left and right, and I genuinely think that that's mainly because the story feels incomplete in the first episode or two. It's hard to connect with the emotionless Violet, and because she's our perspective character, that makes it hard to connect with any of the other employees at CH Postal Service. But once you reach that third episode and see how Violet's experience as a soldier allows her to understand both Spencer's guilt for failing to protect his parents and Luculia's sadness at seeing her brother suffer, conveying the feelings of the one to the other, it all starts to click together. It's that episode that allows us to move past simply understanding the plot intellectually and really connect with it emotionally. And each subsequent episode builds on that understanding. Through witnessing other people go through rejection and finding love, we start to understand the weight of both Violet's feelings and those of Major Gilbert. In watching Violet connect with her fellow orphan, Leon, and seeing his story, we get some emotional context for how hard her life must have been growing up without a family. And through seeing her help Oscar Webster cope with the loss of his daughter, juxtaposed with Violet learning the truth about Major Gilbert's presumed death at the end of that episode, we start to grasp the real magnitude of her own loss, to understand that she has lost the person at the center of her world, and that when she can no longer hold on to the delusion that he might be alive, that world crumbles. Though they're not directly connected, the understanding built up by all of the previous episodes is what allows episodes 8 and 9, exploring Violet's past as well as her personal grief, to work at all. The connections we've made with her give us a jumping-off point to understand the more foreign feelings and experiences at the core of her character development. The Major isn't just the person Violet loves. He's not just the first person to treat her like a person instead of a weapon. He is her reason for existing. Each order he gives her becomes her purpose in life, and everything she does, every life she takes, ultimately serves her goal of protecting him and making him happy. So if the Major is now dead, what that means is that Violet did all of those things, killed all of those people, for no reason. And her newly learned empathy means that she fully understands what each of those deaths mean. Each one is a letter that won't reach home, a story that can never have a happy ending, a person somewhere left mourning forever. If the show just threw all of this at us at the beginning, neither we nor Violet would be able to process it. But with that frame of reference, we can properly grasp the gravity of the situation as Violet sits on the verge of tearing up her room and possessions because she thinks that she doesn't deserve to be happy, and then ineffectually tries to strangle herself with her own hands before collapsing into a sobbing heap. Maybe we don't know everything that's going through her head or everything that she's been through, but we do know enough that the vast, unfathomable anguish she's feeling is able to carry through the screen, aided by stellar animation and beautiful orchestrated music, and hit us right where it hurts. It's not quite as heart-wrenching as the near-perfect episode 10, and there are still some episodes left to go, but this scene is what made watching Violet Evergarden feel like it was worth the journey for me. It paints a stark and brutal picture of what war does to people, both to those who do the killing and those who are left behind. All encapsulated in the silently screaming face of one emotionally devastated girl. If you're a writer, then Violet Evergarden is a must-watch, or at least a must-read. It provides a powerful lesson in the mechanics and techniques required to make your audience connect with characters who've had different experiences from their own and might seem a bit odd. If you're not a writer, I still think it's a must-watch, because it provides a rare and valuable, if exaggerated, glimpse into the struggles that both societies and the people who defend them face in the wake of war. Let me know in the comments below what your favorite war stories in anime and other media are, and what anime have made you cry the hardest. And while you're down there, why not drop a like on the video if you liked it, or a dislike if you felt otherwise, and subscribe to Mother's Basement for more videos every Tuesday and Saturday. By the way, did you know that Violet Evergarden is based on a novel? Unfortunately, you can't read it in English yet, but you can read The Combat Baker and Automaton Waitress, another fantastic light novel about veterans trying to make it in a post-war world that I think Violet Evergarden fans will enjoy a whole lot. To celebrate the release of the third volume ebook, Bookwalker is offering 250 coins back to anyone who buys volume 1 or 2 between now and March 28th. Each coin counts for 1 yen toward a future purchase, and if you use the promo code BASEMENT when you check out, you can get 600 yen off one of the light novels, making the deal even sweeter. And even if you're not interested in Combat Baker, you're in luck, because right now Bookwalker is having a massive rebate sale. Between today, March 20th, and March 22nd, as part of their spring cleaning event, you'll get 30% Bookwalker coins back when you buy any ebook that was released before March 6th and isn't on some other kind of sale. If you'd prefer watching something to reading, though, then check out the latest